aim of this presentation is to show how looking at building activities and urban transformation, it is possible to highlight how the long 11th century, and in particular the moment between the end of the 11th and the first 28 of the 12th, are really crucial for the evolution of the medieval Rome. The data that I will show to you in part move from an important research on medieval Rome that I conducted in Rome under the direction of Alessandra Molinari at University of Tor Vergata. Then the result of this first research move into another important project, the ERC project Petrifying Wealth, directed by Ana Rodriguez from the CCP of Madrid and Sandro Carocci from Tor Vergata again. This consented me to study a lot of building in Rome and all around Rome. 1,600 building, different kind of building, so house, churches, other kind of religious building, but also bell tower, defensive tower, all the restore of the medieval defensive Rome, wall of Rome, so infrastructure about water, for example. So a lot of data, all study according to the methodology of the building archaeologists, that consent to me to have a huge quantity of data and build a chronotypology and seriation of all the technique mensuri that we have in Rome. As you can notice by this slide, for the 11th century, we have a lack of information. And the data start again from the end of the 11th and grow up in the beginning of the 12th and then in the second half of the 12th. This kind of information is a little bit in contrast with what we know from written source. If we think about the reconstruction of the urbanistic development of Rome that, for example, Hubert gave to us, we can have these three important points. A first phase of growth in the first 20 years of the 11th century, a slowdown until the first 20 years of the 12th century, and a new growth between the second half and of the 12th century and the end of the 13th century. Although this last point is really known as the famous Roman urban renaissance, and we have a lot of study about that, and a huge part of the building that we have in Rome are about this moment, we don't know nothing about the context that produced this completely new evolution in the building in Rome. But if we look at all the data that it could be possible to put together for the end of the 11th century and the beginning of the 12th century, what we can notice, it is the presence of a large increase of building activity about church, first of all, in connection with this huge activity that was in connection with the presence of the Pope, Pascal II, in Rome. It is possible also to notice the presence of other important elements. In this moment, in fact, we have a series of elevation and leveling, also up to 5, 4, and 6 meters in certain cases, and all conduct during one single phase. Two good examples of these are the Church of San Crisogono in Rome and the Church of San Clemente in Rome and the Church of San Crisogono, that are characterized in both by two overlapping buildings. So we have the ancient one, for example, in this case, the blue one, and at the end of the 11th century, we have the new one built on the other, but they are in use contemporary because we have trace of great use in both of them. This information is really interesting if we think at the organization of the city. All this information and all these series of elevation and leveling that we can notice also in some point in which we have excavation about medieval house, it is connected as pointed by Federico Guidobaldi as an important urban plan that involves especially road networking. But according to me, this series of elevation and leveling is to connect it to something that is more bigger than a renovation of road and involve also water infrastructure, city orography, and in general the idea that we have of the city in this moment. Together, in fact, with all this transformation, we can speak about another really important element. The building of this river that you can see here. This is an artificial channel that we know was finished in 1122 under the Pope Callistus II. the stream that is famous as the Marana stream, in the reality is the deviation of another river that at the beginning moved in the north of the city, grow up in this point, move then in the Aniene, that is the first tributary of the Tiber, and from this point move inside the city of Rome just a little before the Vatican. So we are in the north of the city. With the deviation that from this point that you can see here, move water in the south. The water of the ancient river was connected with another river, with a sluice, and then move close to the city of Rome in front of Porta Sinara. Here we are close to the Lateran. By this point, the water brings water to a lot of mills. And then by this point, we arrive into the city, moving from Porta Metronia, so the door, another door of the Aurelian Wall was used by this river to move inside the city. By this point, the river start to be an urban stream, cross the Circus Maximus, and then move into the Tiber, a little bit after the Tiber Island. So if we put all together all these elements, here I put for you some evidence from excavation about the riverbed, the sluice, and the embankment that was found in the Circo Maximus. This is the technique of the embankment that is really important and on which I speak to you later. If we put all together all this data about the stream, what we can say is that the water moved from the north. That point is the point in which, before the deviation, the water moved in the Tiber, so just a little before the Vatican. But after the deviation, the water moved in the Tiber here. So in a certain way, we can say that with the organization of this deviation, all this area of the city, that is the place in which grew up the real medieval city in the second half of the 12th century and then in the 13th century, was preserved. This is really important because this area is an area at risk of floods. So if we think this together with all the revelling, it's not true that we have a lack of information about the building activity of Rome. But what we can notice that is that we have in a certain way a kind of background, a moment in which Rome looks like a building site in which everything was changed to transform the city. By this moment, the city start to be something different from the early medieval city that we know, composed by a kind of scattered settlement. By this moment, after all this transformation, the city became a cohesive town, all inside this area. Then, if we look at the position of all the points in which it could be possible to find all this change of orography, what we can notice is that they happen all around these two roads that put in connection the Lateran with the Vatican. So by that moment, Vatican and Lateran start to be the focal point of this new city that start to be concentrated in the middle. These two roads that I show to you are together the roads that compose the famous Via Papalis, that is the road used by the Pope for all the ceremony that from the Lateran move in the Vatican and then come back. On this matter, a comparison with other cities seems useful. Between the Ottonian period and the 12th century, a series of intervention and urban renovation were made that connect the religious context to the urban landscape, allowing its vision from a certain distance and enhancing, however, its impact. In a large variety of solutions adopted, all implying, however, a willingness of intervention, the example of Würzburg, Spira, and Augusta seems appealing. If in the case of Würzburg, the sequence formed by the bridge, the Domstrasse, and the religious building is interesting, in the case of Spira and Augusta, here, we see a monumental unity of the project. With no doubt, the Via Papalis is far away from the Maximilianstrasse of Augusta that was 40 meters wide. But I believe, however, that the example is suitable for the intention of connecting permanently the city with the church, defining in this way a main road for the control and use of city power within a cohesive urban space. Then, One final consideration should be made on the economical importance of this intervention, at least on the work of the Marana stream. The deviation of a river is not something irrelevant, even more if one considers it within the large context of transformation described, that certainly implied a significant economical commitment. We are currently not able to quantify the cost of such a work, but what we can say is, for example, looking at the Mansory technique, here we have the technique used in the embankment of the river, that is the same that we can find in a lot of other buildings datable at the same period that we have in Rome, not inside the city, but all around the city. They are all civil buildings. We don't have the use of this mansory in Rome in this moment in religious building. And sorry. And this technique is the same that we can find in some of the restore into the Aurelian Wall that are all concentrated in the south of the city, that is the same point in which we have the passage of the Marana stream. So what we can say is that all these elements recall in a certain way civic context and allowing to suggest what looks like a possible secular collaboration in all this work in this moment of great transformation. Of course, it's just an hypothesis and is a new way of research that we start nowadays, and so we need to have more data to confirm this, but it's a really interesting element because from the original idea that we have of the city before all this study and from what the written source told to us, what we can say that the end of the 11th century and the beginning of the 12th is a really a background really important for knowing the medieval Rome. Thank you.